Begin to be now what you will be hereafter. Good morning, today is Friday, November 24, 2023. Today in history, on this day 30 years ago, Chinese fluid dynamicist and theoretical physicist Zhou Peiyuan passed away. His academic achievements were mainly in two important aspects of basic physics theory, namely Einstein's general theory of relativity. He is one of the founders of modern Chinese mechanics and theoretical physics. Qing Jiao, bridging the business world and delivering information to you. Welcome to today's Qing Jiao Morning News. Let's start with political updates. Israel announces recall of ambassador to South Africa. Xinhua News Agency reported on November 20 that the Israeli Ministry of Foreign Affairs announced the recall of the country's ambassador to South Africa in response to South Africa's recent stance on the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. Earlier, Israeli media reported that South African President Cyril Ramaphosa expressed disappointment with Israel's ongoing bombing of schools, hospitals, and civilians in the Gaza Strip, as well as its restriction of humanitarian access. In response, the South African cabinet decided to recall all diplomats stationed in Israel and filed a lawsuit with the International Criminal Court, seeking an investigation into the war crimes committed by Israel in the Gaza Strip. The Palestinian-Israeli conflict has resulted in the deaths of over 13,000 Palestinians, including more than 9,000 women and children, and has left over 30,000 people injured. According to official figures, the death toll in Israel is approximately 1,200. Secondly, we'll bring you updates on military-related news. Israel attacks Indonesian hospital in northern Gaza. According to Al Jazeera, on the evening of November 19, the Israel Defense Forces reportedly targeted the Indonesian hospital, a large medical facility in the northern Gaza Strip. Israeli military attacks have claimed the lives of at least 12 individuals, including doctors and patients, in the Indonesian hospital. The Gaza Strip's health department reported that the hospital has been subjected to repeated bombings by the Israeli military, posing life-threatening consequences for patients, medical staff, and refugees. Reports indicate that the Indonesian hospital, situated near the Jabalia refugee camp, Gaza's largest refugee camp, accommodates 150 patients, employs 100 medical staff, and provides shelter for thousands of refugees. Witnesses reported that the Israeli military shot everyone attempting to leave the hospital. Additionally, the hospital's operating room sustained damage, rendering it incapable of performing surgeries. Shells also struck a nearby Kuwaiti school, which serves as a refuge for hundreds of families. Indonesia's foreign minister strongly condemned Israel, labeling the attack as an obvious breach of international humanitarian law. The World Health Organization was appalled by the attack, stating that health workers and civilians should never be exposed to such horrors. It emphatically reminded all parties to the conflict that under international humanitarian law, they are obliged to respect the sanctity of health facilities and actively protect them. Now, let's turn our attention to the latest economic news. China and Saudi Arabia sign $50 billion local currency swap agreement. According to the Associated Press of Finance, the People's Bank of China and the Central Bank of Saudi Arabia recently signed a bilateral local currency swap agreement with a swap scale of 50 billion yuan. The agreement, approved by the State Council of China, is valid for 3 years and can be extended with the consent of both parties. China stated that the trade volume between China and Saudi Arabia is expected to exceed $100 billion in 2022. The signing of a bilateral local currency swap agreement aims to strengthen financial cooperation between the two countries, expand the use of local currencies in their transactions, and promote trade and investment facilitation between China and Saudi Arabia. The 2023 Renminbi Internationalization Report, previously released by the People's Bank of China, indicates that the bank has signed bilateral local currency swap agreements with central banks or monetary authorities in 40 countries and regions, with 29 valid agreements. The total scale of these agreements exceeds 4 trillion yuan. As of the end of September 2023, overseas monetary authorities have actually used an RMB balance of 117.1 billion yuan. The internationalization process of RMB is constantly accelerating. Thailand digital wallet scheme will be in the form of loans. Thailand's Prime Minister Srettha Thavisin recently stated that the government is pursuing a special loan of 500 billion baht, approximately $14 billion, to support the development of a digital wallet scheme. According to the proposed scheme, the Thai government aims to distribute 10,000 baht in digital currency to every Thai individual over 16 years old who has a monthly income of less than 70,000 baht and a bank deposit of less than 500,000 baht. This scheme is anticipated to benefit approximately 50 million eligible individuals. The digital wallet scheme is scheduled to launch in May next year and will remain valid for a duration of 6 months. In addition, Srettha Thavisin also emphasized that the average growth rate of Thailand's economy in the past 10 years was only 1.9%, and household debt accounted for 91.6% of GDP. Therefore, the Thai economy needs a large-scale stimulus package. In addition to the 500 billion baht injected through the digital wallet plan, there is also a 100 billion baht fund to enhance the country's economic potential, including investing in new technologies and developing human resources. The 100 billion baht will be allocated from the national finance. Now, here is some important safety information. Myanmar hands over 31,000 telecom fraud suspects to China. According to CCTV News, responding to the severe situation of Chinese telecom network fraud crimes in northern Myanmar, China's Ministry of Public Security has deployed public security agencies in Yunnan and other regions to enhance border police law enforcement cooperation and conduct multiple rounds of crackdowns. As of now, relevant local law enforcement departments in northern Myanmar have handed over a total of 31,000 suspects involved in telecommunications network fraud to China. This includes 63 behind-the-scenes financiers, organizational leaders, and key figures, along with 1,531 online fugitives. The crackdown has yielded remarkable results. It is understood that since September of this year, public security agencies in China, specifically in Zhishuang Banna, Pu'er, Linsong, and other locations, have collaborated with relevant local law enforcement departments in Myanmar to conduct multiple rounds of crackdowns on telecom network fraud crimes. Starting from November, the Chinese public security agencies intensified their efforts to deepen police law enforcement cooperation between China and Myanmar, launching a fierce offensive against telecom network fraud crimes in northern Myanmar. The relevant official in charge from the Chinese Public Security Agency emphasized their commitment to maintaining sustained pressure on telecommunications network fraud criminal groups in northern Myanmar. They pledged to deepen law enforcement cooperation along the China-Myanmar border, organize specialized crackdowns, eliminate fraud operations, and lawfully apprehend fraudsters. This commitment is aimed at safeguarding the safety, property, and legitimate rights of the people while effectively preserving border security and stability. Cambodian brick factory uses textile waste as fuel. Reuters reported on November 20 that the Cambodian League for the Promotion and Defense of Human Rights released a report. During an investigation conducted from April to September this year, 21 brick factories in Phnom Penh and Kandal province were examined. The investigation revealed that in 7 of these brick factories, workers reported burning textile waste from major international brands, including cloth, plastic, and rubber, which resulted in headaches and respiratory problems. Burning textile waste releases toxic substances harmful to humans, including carcinogens such as dioxins, according to an earlier internal research report by the United Nations Development Programme. Cambodian brick factories use textile waste as fuel primarily to save on fuel costs. Among the textile brands mentioned in the report, Adidas responded that it had launched an investigation to determine whether the waste transportation process deviated from the approved route to the brick factory. Clothing brand Primark and supermarket chain Lidl also stated that they were conducting investigations. Finally, here's some intriguing cultural news. Philippines wins Tourist Destination Award. Recently, Tripzilla, Southeast Asia's leading digital travel company, honored the Philippines with the title of Destination of the Year during the 9th Tripzilla Awards ceremony. Additionally, the Tourism Promotion Committee of the Philippine Department of Tourism received the Sustainability Leader of the Year for Asia from Tripzilla. Furthermore, in the 22nd Annual Wanderlust Readers Travel Awards, the Philippines secured the 4th spot as the most desirable country for adventure. The Secretary of Tourism of the Philippines expressed gratitude for these honors, acknowledging the stunning scenery and excellent tourism services in the country. He extended a warm welcome to tourists from around the world, inviting them to experience the rich culture of the Philippines. Financial newsletter. According to the Securities Times, lithium carbonate futures have experienced a notable overall price decline, particularly in the near-month contract compared to the far-month contract. The main LC2401 contract saw a significant drop of 4.55% to 132,300 yuan per ton, reaching a new low since its listing. The submain LC2407 contract closed at 121,200 yuan per ton, marking a decrease of 2.96%. This led to a narrowed price difference between the two, down to 11,100 yuan per ton. That's all for today's Tsing Chau Morning News. Thank you for listening.